Good morning. Sorry for not wearing the jacket, but I cannot fit in it with my arm. So I think I just move on. And so these are my disclosure. And I will be talking about chronic lymphocytic leukemia. So we are switching again disease, and which is the most common leukemia in among the adults in the Western world. And we will be talking about a study, a phase 3 randomized study involving acalabrutinib, one of the new BTK inhibitors. So in chronic lymphocytic leukemia, I have to say that this is a very exciting period for this disease, because we have a number of the novel drugs, chemo-free drugs that have been approved and that are under development. But still, we are not able to cure the disease, so patients may relapse even after these very effective therapies. And so an issue is also that we have to find the therapies that are better tolerated for our patients, as they have to take these drugs for many, many years. BTK inhibition is a well-known pathway in CLL. It's very effective. Other drugs are already also approved. And so it is definitely something that is a key in the treatment algorithm of CLL. The study I will be talking about is named ASCEND, and it's the first randomized control study evaluating efficacy and safety of acalabrutinib, this new BTK inhibitor that we already proved to be effective and tolerable in a phase 1 study published on the New England Journal of Medicine a few years ago. It is also the first randomized study comparing a BTK inhibitors with, let's say, as monotherapy with standard therapies, like on one side bendamustine plus rituximab, so a chemo immunotherapeutic regimen, or a novel combination of idelalisib, a PI3 kinase delta inhibitor plus rituximab. But the design is here. So we are talking about relapsed refractory CLL, so patients who have been already treated at least once. And the randomization includes on one side either acalabrutinib, oral drug, BTK inhibitor, or on the other side, physician choice. So the physician had the possibility to choose between either a chemotherapeutic, a well-established chemotherapeutic regimen, a typical second, third line treatment, bendamustine plus rituximab, or a chemo-free, so let's call it a novel chemo-free, which is already approved and utilized in the community, idelalisib plus rituximab. Acala, again, is monotherapy, not in combination with anything. So these are the results. The therapy is effective. There is a reduction in the risk of progression and death by 69% using acalabrutinib. PFS, progression-free survival, median PFS has not been reached for acalabrutinib. It is 16.5 months for the control arm, which is including either bendamustine plus rituximab or idelalisib plus rituximab. And the median follow-up is 15.1. And just to compare the difference, because you can see it here visually, but at 12 months, the patients who did not progress were 88% with Acala and were 68% in the control arm. So already after 1 year, the difference was quite obvious. Talking about safety, which is also an extremely important issue in chronic lymphocytic leukemia, in particular when we talk about therapies that have been that have to be taken continuously until progression or intolerance. The safety profile of acalabrutinib didn't show anything unexpected compared to the initial study, the phase 1. And in particular, it showed a better profile compared to either chemotherapy, so less neutropenia or any bone marrow toxicity compared to chemotherapy, and also compared to idelalisib plus rituximab, which is, as I said, a chemo-free treatment, but has, for example, a high frequency of diarrhea and colitis and other side effects. The typical side effect of acalabrutinib, headache, is there, but it's transient, a couple of weeks. The patient usually don't even need anything to treat, and it's really also transient during the day, so a couple of hours after taking the pill, and then it fades away. So in general, acalabrutinib was very well tolerated. Other typical side effects of BTK inhibition, like bleeding, were definitely very infrequent. Only 1/4 of the patients will have it. And atrial fibrillation, which is again a typical side effect of BTK inhibition, was shown only in 5% of the patients. So in conclusions, here I presented the data of the ASCEND study, randomized phase 3 in relapsed refractory patient, and it shows that acalabrutinib is more effective and better tolerated than other established and approved treatments. And I have also to say that there's been a press release earlier this year showing, reporting another study involving acalabrutinib in first-line treatment-naive patients, where we don't know the details, but the endpoints have been reached. So these two studies will be likely important to achieve approval of the drug and therefore maybe expanding the possibility of treatment for our patients. Thank you very much for your attention.
With hematology news. So how does this compare with ibrutinib? Has ibrutinib been used in this population? And is it
$1 million question.
Yeah.
We will be able to answer very soon, I hope, let's say soon, because there is an ongoing trial comparing head-to-head acalabrutinib to ibrutinib. So we will be seeing efficacy and tolerability of the two drugs. So that will be the answer to your question. But just to speculate...
Sorry, in monotherapy or in combination?
In monotherapy.
Okay.
Both of them in monotherapy.
Okay.
Really very easy, I would say, obvious trial. It's taking very long because, of course, also ibrutinib is a very good drug. And therefore, it's really... we expect any time to see results. But in general, as I said, this is the first time that a BTK inhibitor has been used as monotherapy and compared to either chemotherapy or the novel therapies. Because ibrutinib, for example, has been compared to ofatumumab or to chlorambucil or chlorambucil plus as a monotherapy only to chlorambucil. So it's difficult really to compare because the comparators and the control arms are completely different. Bendamustine plus rituximab is the typical second line, I would say, treatment. There has been no head-to-head trial with novel therapies like idelalisib, so I think this is the novelty of our study.
Thank you.
Do you have any other questions? What about subset responses?
We don't see differences. Now we are quite used to this. When we don't use chemotherapy, all the typical subsets, genetic subsets, P53 patients with P53 mutations or with deletion 17P, that you could really stratify and see differences when you use chemotherapy, immunochemotherapy. Now it doesn't show anymore. In this study, they were allowed to be enrolled, and again, we didn't see any difference. Also, patients with unmutated immunoglobulin genes, which is again predictor of poor response to immunochemotherapy, here they didn't show any difference. So mutated and unmutated patients were responding as well. So we definitely have to think about new science to find the predictors of loss of response to these new therapies, because indeed, as I said, we are not curing our patients. So even if after many years these patients will progress, some of these patients at least, so we have to really to identify who will benefit, for example, of a combination of these new therapies.
Okay. And if you could start a new trial tomorrow without spending 4 years defending it, negotiating it, and financing it, what would you do with this agent?
I think that the future for this agent, like for every agent in CLL, is that probably we have to get rid of the continuous treatment for obvious reasons, for economical reasons also, but also in order to avoid clonal selection, and so we don't keep pressure on the clonal cells. So I would do combination that allow us to get to a clear, definite, deep response so that we can stop treatment. Acalabrutinib has been already, as I mentioned earlier, studied with obinutuzumab in first line, maybe that will already lead to deeper responses. An obvious combination will be with venetoclax. So anything that can help us to reduce the time of treatment will be beneficial.
Great.